Last Sunday, there was a gentleman visiting in the service that was a friend of mine from college days. I was probably about 18 years old when I got acquainted with Jim Arnett. And we were college friends. We went to different schools, but through church and social activities and running around together, we were longtime friends. I mentioned him, he couldn't be here today, but he wanted to come last Sunday, because when I was about 20 years old, as I recall, I, quote, preached my first sermon. We were at the time members of First Baptist Church in Huntington Park, a suburb of the Los Angeles area. My dad worked for Safeway Stores and had been transferred to California. In my last semester of high school, I went one semester of high school in California and graduated. Made lots of dear friends, you know, in one semester, sure. But Jim was there, and when I was called upon in that church, First Baptist in Huntington Park, church had probably ran about 700 or 800 in attendance, a very large sanctuary, old Gothic style building, beautiful building. And Dr. Lewis Emerson Maples was pastor at that time, and he called upon me. We were having a youth Sunday to preach the sermon. And I diligently prepared and looked at some sermon books to try to get some ideas, something I'd never done before, and prepared my sermon. I thought I was ready, because I knew, as he told me, you've got about 25 minutes to fill up. And I remember when I took a speech class in college, the professor said, "You're not afraid of what you're going to say when you get up on your feet. You're afraid of that you're not going to be able to say anything once you're up on your feet in front of people." I experienced that day. That 25, 30 minute sermon that I had prepared, I went through it in about 7 minutes. And I was shaking so bad. Some of the people said in the choir that my pants were just trembling. And so I looked at the middle of the sermon and I started there. I went that way and tried to fill out some time. And I could see this big clock in the back. And my time wasn't up. So then I started in the middle and I went the other way toward the front. I think I gave him about 18 minutes total. That was my first attempt at preaching. I was nervous, if you haven't figured that out. Going on, finishing college, going off to seminary in Texas, great experience. And then after being there about a year, being called a pastor of a church in Myra, called Myra Baptist Church, up near Gainesville, Texas, up near the Oklahoma line. And I was thrilled at the prospect. I was wanting to get started, knowing that preachers had to get started somewhere. Small rural church, small town, about 400 or 500 people then. I became pastor at Myra Baptist Church. Wonderful, dedicated, country people. When they had dinners, they spread the tables, and it was a wonderful time. And I stumbled and chewed on my sermon notes and everything for 2 years. Took me about 5 or 6 months to get to where I could eat lunch after church. I was so torn up with the responsibility of being the preacher. But I loved it, and I've enjoyed it so very much. So that was about 2 years there, and from Texas, came to California, and came to this church, called to be pastor of this church. The first Sunday of March, not far away, of 1968, I was still 27 years old. I had my first, my 28th birthday after arriving here. God blessed, and I've enjoyed it. There have been times that I was hurting about things. I'm really thankful for the years, though, because we had very little difficulties in our church life over the years. Sometimes churches are hurt with things that happen, but it has been a great trip, a great journey, and so many, many people have come through this church. If we could count them up, I know there would be thousands and thousands of people who have worshiped with this congregation just in the days that I've been here, let alone the 9 pastors who were before me, maybe 8. This morning, I invite you to turn your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 11. This is one of my favorite chapters in the Bible. It's often referred to as God's Hall of Fame. That in the scriptures were written words about notable people. And as is recorded about their life in the Bible, what they did because they followed God. And I want us to read that. God is preparing our homecoming. I know you don't want to make the trip right now. And if we tried to get a plane load together, whether we were going to Michigan or whatever, you wouldn't want to go right now. Some of you are planning to go with Peoria and watch the Padres play ball in the next couple of weeks. Dawn, I hope you enjoy it. Isn't that something? She accepts the responsibility and then takes off. But those bulletins are already prepared. She took care of it. To all of you who are taking responsibilities, I noticed that four people have assumed the responsibilities that Maureen was doing. That tells you something about her capabilities and what she was doing. But you're gracious to do it. You've taken the time to come in and spend hours in preparation. And the church will carry on. And we're praying for you. And God will bless you. But really, we are preparing for a homecoming. This is the last time this assembly of people will gather. This day will not occur again. I doubt that there will be another day when this same group will come together for a worship hour. But one day, we're going to gather up there with God. I don't know who the brother was, but somebody shouted a hallelujah or something, as I recall. I thought it was probably him. Brother Deb, enjoyed your fellowship. And we should be shouting. I can remember when I was a kid, even in Baptist churches, when people still got happy and shouted, glory, hallelujah, whatever, just because they were happy. Now, we don't do that anymore because we're sophisticated, Brother Wayne. God has settled us down, and His Holy Spirit doesn't stir us and cause such erratic behavior. Now, what Dan did, that's unusual. Brothers and sisters, we've got a homecoming, and one day we're going to meet again. Like that wonderful hymn that Rod led us in before the offering. When we all get to heaven, what's the next line? What a day of rejoicing that will be. Amen. Hebrews chapter 11, if you'll follow with me in reading. God is preparing our homecoming. Hebrews 11. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. If you want a definition that is encompassing about what faith is, this is it. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. You can't see it. If you could see it, it'd be real. You wouldn't need faith. It's the things that we hope for. The evidence, the satisfaction that we have in our heart of the things that we cannot see. First, he says, for the elders obtained a good report. Through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear,